You're an executive with GM Holden here, the company that produces the Commodore that Ben was driving in that story. Do you accept that these fine particles pose a serious health risk?
Well, I think it's generally accepted that, yes, there is some health risk associated with that. But the industry's been moving to improve the standards. And like in Australia at the moment, we're on Euro 4 standards. We're in line with the European system. But I think the only way that this can move ahead is that you have to have consultation between the industry, and it's got to be driven by data. So if the data's there, I don't really see why the industry would be resisting it that much. There's obviously some limitations on how quickly the industry can move.
John?
Well, the data is there. I mean, Professor Carney made it clear. We know about the small and ultra-fine particles. The real issue is the car companies have been slow in adopting technologies which will reduce those ultra-fine particles. The problem is the government. We need regulatory standards that create a level playing field for the car companies so they're not economically disadvantaged by producing cars which are more expensive and more expensive to maintain.
So you're sheeting this home to governments?
Well, governments shouldn't cave into the motor car manufacturers so easily, and they should drive faster standards. These are things we need to address urgently if we're not to see soaring rates of lung disease.
Vic Johnson, Toyota prides itself on the idea of good corporate governance. Do you have these filters on your cars for these ultra-fine particles?
It's diesel particulate and NOx reduction filters are available, particularly in Europe. And
to meet
those
standards,
we do have NOx reduction filters on our new diesel cars because they've got to come in now and meet the Euro 4 standards, in fact, exceed them.
So you've been forced to do that, really?
Not necessarily. We've been actually moving forward very quickly. In fact, we have very strict standards in Japan, much more strict than Australia. And they've already exceeded their 2010 limitations or the goals. They've exceeded them in 2006.
We're hearing this argument that the car companies are resisting, that they're pushing back against this, and that it's only going to be government that will force you to do it.
One of the limitations in Australia is the fuel. To make these particulate filters and so on work, you need to have sulphur reduction in the fuel. Our current level of sulphur in fuel is about 50 parts per million, and it needs to come down to 10 parts per million before those filters will work, because otherwise the sulphur poisons the catalyst.
Over to you, Frank. The fuel.
I think it might take issue, Jenny. The fact is that the oil companies in Australia have strongly backed cleaner fuels so we can get pollution down. And from 2009... our diesel in Australia will be at 10 parts per million of sulphur. Now that's the key parameter, the key component of diesel, which allows for car engines to have very sophisticated anti-pollution equipment to get their pollution down.
But I guess what I'm interested in, and what a lot of people watching this are going to be interested in, is if we have the science that says these particles are really dangerous, why aren't you going at breakneck speed to make it better, to fix it?
Well, that's where I come back. Really, that comes down to the government and the industry sorting out when they want to do this.
John?
Yeah, with respect, the history of this is not industry and government moving together. It's industry telling government what they want and government being dragged, kicking and screaming by political pressure from outside, from people like Professor Carney. We've got to turn that around. We've got to get governments that no longer are told by the industry, oh, we can't achieve that, or it'll wreck jobs here, or it'll undermine the industry there.
Vic, you wanted to say something?
I'm just hearing the discussion. It sounds like everybody's looking for leadership from somebody or who's going to take the helm. I deal a lot with government, but the lowest take-up rate of safety features from our cars is with our government fleet buyers. So the cars they buy don't necessarily have the same safety features they tell you to buy.
All right, I would have loved to have someone from the government here tonight, and we did put out a very broad invitation, but we unfortunately don't have anyone here. Is a level playing field what you want, Richard? Like, if the government were to announce tomorrow a whole new set of strict regulations on this sort of thing, but everybody had to deal with them, would that be acceptable? Or would you still be resisting moving too quickly?
Yeah, if the government did decide just to put a blanket requirement over Australia, that would make it extremely difficult for the industry to deal with.
So you would resist?
We would just explain to them that this is what it meant to the industry. In the end, it's the government's choice on what they wish to do.
You would just explain to them that it was...
Exactly.
Exactly.
Right. And
I think we all know what that
means. There would be no threat of closing down a car factory if they didn't conform to what you wanted?
Well, no, we would simply put on the facts on the table of, that this is the investment we've made in the country, this with regards to, the Commodore represents a $1 billion investment. that if something was to change overnight and we couldn't respond to it quickly, well, this is just what the impact it would have on the business.
And Vic, would Toyota respond in a similar way?
I think so, but we've got to anticipate what government or the market wants. And we're fortunate, we're like General Motors, we're a global company, so we can lean on our parent company for technologies. But it's like the chicken and the egg, who owns which, whether it's fuel or government or the motor cars, or the market. The market will actually drive what people buy.
I'd like to talk a little bit about car dependency and get back to that whole issue of car dependency, because all these things are interrelated. Matt, we know your Ferrari is the thing you use on the weekends, but do you really need two cars the rest of the time, even if they're hybrids?
Yes, just for school sports. Both our daughters go to different directions. They've got different sports events on Saturday mornings. During the week, I go a totally different direction. I suppose if we plan better, we could somehow rearrange our timetables, but it would there would be a lot of clashes.
So you wouldn't want to inconvenience yourself to the point where you gave up one of the cars?
Well, I can't. Our kids have to turn up to school, and if they don't turn up, they get detention, so they wouldn't be too happy for a start.
What about other people here? I mean, how would your lives work without using your cars as much? Karen, what about you? You said that you were really aware of some of these issues. How car dependent are you?
Well, we live 2.5 kilometres from the nearest public transport, and even though I don't work very far away, which is only about 5 kilometres, I have to carry a lot of heavy things to and from work, being a teacher, books and equipment, things. I think it would be very hard if I had to find my way down to public transport.
Because what I'd like to get, everyone says, oh, if there was better public transport, I wouldn't use my car as much. But we've heard tonight about just how much people are wedded to their cars, how much they love using their cars. And I wonder if you're all honest with yourselves, even if there was public transport, whether you'd still be using cars, would you, or not?
My family and I live in Singapore for 10 years. In that 10 years there, we never owned a car. Okay? In fact, you can live without owning a car, provided there is good transport system, frequency, as well as convenience. Okay? We have lived there for 10 years without a car. Admittedly, I think I still miss my car while we're still living in Singapore.
Vanessa, yeah.
It would probably take me a 20-minute drive to get to transport, and then just to get to the city alone, which would probably take me an hour if there's no traffic to get to the city. Public transport, I'd have to get off, change stations about 3 times. It's just totally inconvenient. It would just never work, the transport out in my country area anyway. And then the amount of use I see with cattle and the whole transport to horses and all of that, I mean, I don't know how far in the future if they're wanting to change this, but there's so much farming equipment that uses the same fuel. I mean, this is not just cars as well. So I don't know. I don't think it's very accessible to get here, and it's not something that...
But would you, if it was,
oh, if it
let's
was,
say you
definitely.
Lived in the city, but would you be still be driving everywhere because you love cars as much as you do?
Well, I definitely changed my way of getting to and from work. I definitely have my weekends where I'd want to race. Whether that would change fuel-wise, I don't know. But I don't think it's something that is affordable. I don't think people really know what's going on with the impact of fuel and the pollution. I mean, for me, it's half a shock too. I mean, I know it pollutes, but I didn't know it was as dangerous as what people are saying, and that people are actually, you know, suffering severely from it. It's sort of
and
a
dying.
Bit of a shock. Yeah, well, I mean, where's the education on that?
Terry? I wonder, though, how this future scenario that we're looking at, the combination of peak oil, climate change and so on, are going to affect people who are really heavily car dependent. And Australia is hugely car dependent. I think it's only second to the US in terms of car dependency.
Yeah, and look, certainly here in Los Angeles, we invented sprawl, we invented freeways and traffic jams. I was almost late to come to the studio for this program tonight, stuck in a Friday afternoon traffic jam for us here in our time zone here in California. But look, I think in the future, what we're talking about tonight is innovation, the need to evolve. Change is hard, but it's inevitable, especially when it's motivated by things like public health, by running out of oil, and by global warming. So I think innovation is going to help us out a lot.
Well, coming up, we are going to talk about new technology and cleaner fuels and whether they might help save the car and the planet. We'll be back soon.